Amen. It's nice after a fellowship here in the auditorium, you can kind of pick out what you ate last night while you're sitting here, and good memories. Somebody suggested this morning, I think it was Jim and Amy, that we could have a breakfast buffet on the day after Faith Promise banquet on Sunday morning, and that would probably be a motivation for folks to get here, but I don't know, that might be a little too much work. Acts chapter 13, I want to talk to you for a few moments this morning here in our Sunday school hour, and we'll be back in our Bible discovery groups next Sunday. But I want to talk to you this morning about the kind of church that God uses as a sending church. And, you know, this Faith Promise week and this missions conference, I feel like the Lord is putting our focus again on being a sending church. God has given us the opportunity to send a number of men to the field, as well as to be involved in seeing churches planted here in the United States. And I hope that you never forget what a privilege that is. When God raises up people in the church and we have the opportunity to send them out, that is God's blessing on our ministry. And we ought to pray for that to abound more and more. And I want to talk to you this morning about what it means to be a sending church, the kind of church that God uses. And here in Acts chapter 13, we're going to read the first three verses. The church at Antioch was certainly a remarkable church and was known for their efforts. And of course, they sent Barnabas and Saul to the work, Saul who would become Paul. And actually, we owe so much of what we have today and the fact that we are even here today as a church to the faithfulness of the church at Antioch. Because it was ultimately their faithfulness in sending Barnabas and Saul. Later, Paul would separate from Barnabas and would carry on with the gospel. And it was their faithfulness that meant that the gospel went to Europe and eventually here, and our lives are touched as a result. And so we see how that has affected us. But look in verse number 1 of Acts chapter 13. The Bible says, "Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, 'Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them.' And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away." Now we know at this same era, there were other men who were being sent out by churches for the work of the ministry and for church planting. But here in Acts 13, we find the clearest example in all of the scripture of what it means to send someone to the work. And there is a clear pattern that is laid out here in Acts chapter 13, that the work of evangelism, the work of planting churches, what we call the work of missions, belongs to the Lord's churches. It is the Lord's church that ought to be involved in that. And you know, the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28 was given to the disciples not individually, but it was given to them as a New Testament church. And it's implied in Matthew 28 that all true churches will continue to be involved in that Great Commission that Jesus gave to that first church which he founded. Now, I believe it is our responsibility and actually the reason for our existence that we would be involved in this work of the Great Commission. Now, there's some ideas today that have really taken root, even among independent Baptists, which suggests that churches are not really equipped to be the sending agency for men who would go to the field. And I'm not going to preach on that this morning. I'm not going to teach on that. But I want to take just a moment and I want to point out to you that we never find anything other than a New Testament church being responsible for sending men to the work in the New Testament. There is no such thing in the New Testament as a Bible college. There is no such thing in the New Testament as a mission board. So it's confusing to me, for instance, when a Bible college takes upon them the task as a Bible college of ordaining men to the ministry. That doesn't belong to them. The work of ordaining men to the ministry is the work of a New Testament church. In like manner, the work of sending men to the work is the work of a New Testament church. And there's a lot of people today, even in independent Baptist churches, who believe that we need to delegate this process to what are called mission boards, And they're considered to be missions professionals. It's considered that they're super specialized and they know what they're doing, and so they can do a better job than churches can do. And I'm going to tell you this morning, that's unscriptural, and it subverts and it goes around the authority of the New Testament church. Inevitably, what happens is, and it's interesting how it all plays out. Today, mission boards say that they're there to be servants to the churches. They're there to help the churches. But you let there be a problem with the missionary, and you're going to find that the mission board will be the one that deals with them rather than their home church, their sending church. A lot of guys have a sending church that they never even visit. The sending church just authorizes them. It's a name on their letterhead. And when they come back to the States, they may live in a different place. They don't even visit that church. They have nothing to do with it. That is not the way that God designed it. God designed this process to take place so that families from a church are sent to the work, and they come back to that church to report and to fellowship and to be connected. And we see that in the scriptures. Now, if we think about what happened in the first generation of these churches, we realize that the apostles and those that were affected by their ministry, those who were sent out by these churches, literally turned the world upside down. And they did so without the aid of these parachurch organizations. And so this morning, we want to just very firmly remind you and put before you the idea that it's God's will that churches would be sending men. We're going to talk about that in particular in just a moment. Now, I want to also say, you know, I'm not upset with guys who go to the mission field and use a mission board to get to the mission field. I'm thankful for anyone who will go and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And a lot of times those are sincere people. Perhaps they're confused about church doctrine or some such thing. I appreciate their willingness to go. I'm not mad at them. They often we get calls from men who are seeking support here at this church. Our policy is we only support men who are sent out directly by their church. All their finances are handled by their church, not through a clearinghouse. All the authority for them going rests in the church that is sending them, and we want there to be a strong relationship between them and the church that is sending them. That's a philosophical and doctrinal position that we have at our church, and we hold to that. Now, we're appreciative of anybody who's preaching the gospel, but we ought to ask the question this morning, how did this idea of mission boards come into place in the first place? And where did that come from? And you know, it was in 1792 that the first Baptist Mission Board was formed in England, and it was formed by a fella who was actually a remarkable missionary. His name was William Carey, and he was going to go to India, and he would eventually translate the scriptures into the Indian language, and God would greatly bless and use his ministry there in India. And he and 11 other preachers formed that first mission board. And you know, the reason that that happened was because the churches, the Baptist churches in England, had stopped doing their job. They had stopped sending men to the work. In fact, William Carey felt so impressed that he needed to go to India, and he tried to have his church send him to the work, and his church refused. And what had taken place was hard-shell Calvinism had taken over the churches to the place that they had become very complacent and content to say, if God wants to save people in other countries, he'll save it, and he doesn't need our help. And that's a completely unbiblical approach. So we see the mission boards came into play because of the negligence of the churches there in England. And from there, there were other boards that were started. Today, there's many mission boards that men try to go through. And you know, this morning, we might gripe about some of the things that we disagree with about mission boards. But the truth of the matter is that instead of griping about those things, we should be asking the question, are we doing what our master has commanded us to do? As a New Testament church, are we a church that God can and will use as a sending church? Now, I want to point out this morning to those of us from Lehigh Valley Baptist Church, we are privileged because God has allowed us to send men to the work. But I want to ask you this question as we think about this type of church, the church that the Church of Antioch was. I want to ask you this question this morning. Are we content? Are we to the place as a church where we say, this is enough? We've sent enough men to the work. This is good enough. There's not really more that God wants us to do. And I'm going to challenge that because I think it's easy for us to become content. But when is our task completed? when Christ comes back or when the whole world is reached, right? Is the whole world reached? Okay, so we still have a job to do. And so we ought to be asking the question this morning, are we doing everything that we can do so that God can use us as a sending church? Now here in Acts chapter 13, we find this church, the church at Antioch, which was a model of what it means to be a sending church. God would use them, of course, to send Saul and Barnabas to the work. In that first missionary journey, there would be churches that would be planted all through Asia Minor, which would impact that entire region with the gospel and is a remarkable testimony of the power of God to work through a New Testament church. Now turn back in your Bibles to Acts chapter 11 because I want to show you something about this church at Antioch, and I want to give you four thoughts about a church that God uses as a sending church, or four marks of a church that God uses as a sending church. And the first thing I want to point out to you is God uses a church that is supernatural. And what I mean by that is a church that is seeing God working in their midst. And it's undeniably the work of God. So that we couldn't just say, well, it's just religion, or it's just a bunch of people getting together in a religious group. But rather, God uses churches that realize it's all God's power to accomplish this. And I want you to see some things here in Acts chapter 11. This is at the very early days of the church at Antioch. You know that persecution had come on the church at Jerusalem, and the believers from Jerusalem were scattered. They went everywhere preaching the word. And we know that many people had been saved. Many thousands of people had been saved on the day of Pentecost. They were not at home in Jerusalem, because they came from all different parts of the world, like it tells us in Acts chapter 2. And yet after they got saved and followed in believers' baptism, they joined themselves with the church at Jerusalem. They stayed there as long as they could. Now persecution came, Acts chapter 8. Persecution came upon the church that was there in Jerusalem. And because of that, the believers had to scatter. Many of them went back to the places where they were originally from, where they had come to Jerusalem from. And they went back to their homes and back to the places where they had lived before. Antioch was one of those places. Antioch was a major city. It was an influential city. And evidently some people who had gotten saved on the day of Pentecost went back to their city and they began preaching the gospel. Well, word came back to the apostles in Jerusalem that there was a remarkable thing that was happening in Antioch. And the apostles in Jerusalem said, we need to send a faithful man to find out what is going on there in the city of Antioch and to just validate the work and make sure that what's going on there is of the Lord. And in Acts chapter 11, Barnabas comes, and the Bible says there in verse 22, then tidings of these things came unto the ears of the church, which was in Jerusalem. And they sent forth Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch, who, when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord. For he is a good man and full of the Holy Ghost and of faith, and much people was added unto the Lord. Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for to seek Saul. And when he'd found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. So Barnabas comes to the city of Antioch. And isn't it interesting, by the way, did you pick up on this? The persecution which began in Jerusalem, which scattered the believers, was started and was carried on by a fellow named Saul. But in the meanwhile, Saul has gotten saved. Now, because of that persecution, the believers have been scattered everywhere preaching the word. And this fellow Barnabas is going to go and check out some of the work. And he's going to end up in Antioch. And eventually he's going to come back and get the persecutor, Saul, who's now been converted, and bring him to work with him in Antioch. Now, I said to you that the kind of church that God uses is a church that is supernatural. And I want to point out to you here in verses 22 and 23, the Bible tells us that there was a great work of God's grace that was going on in the city of Antioch. This church that was then assembled at Antioch that Barnabas went to find out about, it says in verse 23, who, when he came and had seen the grace of God, he was glad and he exhorted them all. The word grace means God's undeserved favor. And you know, a church ought to be a testimony of God's undeserved favor. When we look around at the congregation of Lehigh Valley Baptist Church, we ought to say, well, glory to God. Because He's the only one who could do this. Who could, other than God, who could bring a group of people like this together? And if we took the time this morning to talk about where we all come from and how the Lord brought us here, and now we've covenanted together as a New Testament church to be involved in this work of evangelism, this is a tremendous testimony of the grace of God. And many of you can look back in your lives and you can see how God brought you to salvation, and you can just marvel at the fact that the grace of God has been evident in your life, that you've been touched by the grace of God. I think as a church, if we ever get past the wonder of God's grace, if we ever get to the place where we start deserving or thinking that we deserve this or that blessing of the Lord, then we've gotten too far. You see, Barnabas was struck by the thought, God's grace is real. God's grace is evident here in the church at Antioch. And because of that, he saw some people who were truly converted, some people who were gathered together and assembled. And this was a mark of the grace of God. But then notice in verse 26, after he went then and he got Saul and he brought him back. And there in Antioch, it says in verse 26 that they assembled with the church that was in Antioch for an entire year. And they taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. And I want to think about that phrase there, they taught much people. Because we said a church that God uses is supernatural. And what we see going on in the church at Antioch is spiritual growth. We find that there is a lot of spiritual growth that is taking place. Now remember, these are young believers. This is a young church. It's only been in existence for perhaps a year. And they're already excited about the work that God has called them to. There is some teaching that's going on. There's a deepening of their walk and understanding of doctrine. And you know, one of the marks of a sending church, and it's a supernatural thing, is that there should be in the lives of the members of that church an ongoing work of sanctification and growth in the grace of God. So it's not just, well, I got saved 30 years ago or 35 years ago, but it is, God is real to me today. I'm growing in my Christian walk. The Lord is challenging me about this thing or that thing. And there ought to be this kind of fellowship in the church where we're challenging one another and we're growing together as believers. Now, you know that this process of growth is sometimes uncomfortable. And maybe some of you remember when you were in junior high and maybe early high school years, you know, those growing pains that you would get. And sometimes your knees would hurt. And some of you, now you're older and you get growing pains other ways, but your knees would hurt and your arms would hurt. And I remember sometimes I'd go to my mom, oh, my knees hurt and my back hurts and my arms hurt. And she'd say, son, it's just growing pains. You're growing. Your body is hurting because it's growing so fast. You know what happens sometimes is growing can hurt. And when we grow spiritually, it can hurt. Because the process of growing spiritually is weeding out some sin in our life and making us more like Christ. A part of that process, as we pointed out before, is sometimes the fact that as believers, we don't always get along with each other, do we? There's differences that we have, and we kind of rub up against each other, and we sometimes rub each other the wrong way. And part of the work of sanctification is learning how to show love to people that don't always make you happy, that don't always do what you want them to do. And this is how we grow in grace. You know, the mark of a church where God is at work is that there is spiritual growth in the individual lives of the members. We ought to be able to look back and say, yes, God is growing us individually, and God is growing us corporately. As a church, we're growing more into the image of Christ. So God's grace was evident. Spiritual growth was evident. And in verse 26, the culmination of this, at the very end of the verse, it says the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. Excuse me, the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. That word Christian, which has now been taken just as a general term for anyone who is a follower of Christ, was used in the city of Antioch as a term of derision. And it was a mockery. Oh, those little Christs. those people who are trying to be like Jesus Christ. And yet what a desire that we all ought to have. And I'm going to say this, when God is at work in a New Testament church, there ought to be a growing evidence of Christ-likeness. There ought to be in our lives the evidence that God is making us more like the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand this morning that you're not like Christ? That you're not yet fully like Him? And one of the reasons that God brings you to a New Testament church is so that you can grow to be more like the Lord Jesus Christ. We ought to have that in our mind. This is what was going on at the church at Antioch. It was a supernatural church. God was working there. And I believe, because of what we believe about the doctrine of the church, that the church is the body of Christ, that the church is the bride of Christ, and that the church is the building of Christ. And what we mean to say by that is the Lord Jesus Christ is in the church. The Lord Jesus Christ wants to fellowship with us. And the work that goes on here is not primarily our work, it is His work. It is a supernatural thing to be a part of a New Testament church. Now go back to Acts chapter 13, because a church that's going to be ascending church is a church that is experiencing the miraculous work of God, experiencing the fact that God is in the midst. Without that, we have no business sending men to the field. Without the understanding that God is working in our midst, then we're not going to be equipped or ready to be able to send men to the field. Now, I'm not saying that we need to be perfect. I'm just saying that in your life and in mine, us as a church corporately, we should be looking for God to be working in this place, because that's the kind of church that God uses. The second thing we see about the kind of church that God uses, though, is found in verse number 2 of Acts 13. And the Bible there names a number of prophets and teachers who were there in the church at Antioch. By the way, a church that is vibrant and a church that is growing and a church that has the hand of God on it, in the New Testament, they always had many different men who had the call of God on their life. There were many different men that God was calling from that place, and they were serving in different ways. So we have all these different men who were prophets and teachers. We would suggest that there was a plurality of shepherds in that assembly. These were men who were doing the work of a pastor, and we understand that there was most likely someone who was what we would call today the senior pastor, someone who was looked to. But there was a number of ministry opportunities and needs in that church such that one man could not fulfill them all. And so there was a group of men who were serving the Lord. And the Bible says there in verse 2, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." Now, of course, verse 2, speaking about the ministering to the Lord, is referring to the men who were named in verse number 1. But I think it's also referring to the entire church. And the reason I believe that is because in verse 2, we find who is spoken to. It's the church, isn't it? The church is spoken to by the Holy Spirit. Y'all have to engage your brains a little bit, all right? So as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul." Who did the Holy Ghost speak to? He spoke to the church. And it was the church, they, who were ministering to the Lord and fasting. So they were involved. And the second thing that I want you to see about a church that God uses to be a sending church is that it is a serving church. Yes, it's a supernatural church, but second of all, it is a serving church. You see, if we get the mentality that church is a place where we go to sit and to receive, then we got the wrong mentality. Because a church is an assembly. It is a group of people. It's not a building at all. It's a group of people, and every member who is a part of a New Testament church is called to be a part of the ministry of that New Testament church. So there's these men who are ministering to the Lord, but there is also a great need for every member to be busy about the work that God wants us to do. It is a church that is serving. Now, I want you to note there in that verse, verse number 2, who is the ministry directed towards? To the Lord. Ministry to the Lord. Just real quick, and this is a sort of unattached thought, which we'll just throw in for free. There's no extra charge for this. When we start ministering to other people primarily, or for other people primarily, we are bound to be disappointed. People will let you down. People will hurt you. If in your Christian life you get focused on, well, I'm going to do a Bible study with someone as long as they respond the right way and they get saved, you're not going to do many Bible studies, because you're going to find out that the vast majority of people you do a Bible study with are going to walk away. Is that accurate? That actually you're going to find that they're not all going to get saved. They're not all going to do what they're supposed to do. And if you're doing it for man, you're going to be disappointed and you're going to get discouraged, and pretty soon you're going to quit. There's a lot of believers in New Testament churches who have stopped serving the Lord, who have gotten to the place where they maybe said, I've done my time. I've served enough. Listen, I've accumulated enough hours. I'm in retirement now. I'm in the Christian retirement community, and I no longer need to serve the Lord. That's ridiculous. God has not called any of us to retire from serving Him. There's ministry that is directed to the Lord. When our ministry is directed to the Lord, that word ministry or ministering speaks about service. And when our ministry or our service is focused on the Lord, do you know you will find that the Lord will lead you to serve others? The great commandment is, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, and mind. The second, Jesus said, is like unto it, love thy neighbor as thyself. The implication is, if you love God the way you ought to, you'll love your neighbor. We could just as easily say, if you're serving God, He's going to lead you to serve others. But the focus is not on others and how they respond. The focus is on God, who I am serving. It's on God who's going to give the reward. You see, a church that is really excited about serving the Lord and has their eyes on the Lord is a church that is going to be raising up laborers. It's a church that is going to be finding that men will be coming up, that young people will be coming up, and they'll be saying, I want to serve the Lord. I want to live for the Lord. I want to please the Lord. You know, our prayer as a church ought to be, Lord, raise up more men from this church that we can send forth. Lord, please don't be done with us. Don't let us be content with where we're at right now. We ought to be asking God for that. You know, we have four men that are getting ready to graduate from our Bible Institute this year. And that's a great blessing. But we ought to be asking about, okay, Lord, where's the next group? Where's the next ones that you're going to call? Who else are you going to raise up to be involved in the work of the ministry? So a church that is serving is a church that God can use for the work of the ministry and to send men into the field. So we said a church that is supernatural and a church that is serving. But now I want you to see a third mark of a church that God uses as a sending church. And that is, it's a church that's spiritual. A church that's spiritual. You see there in verse 2, the Bible says, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said. So I'm not going to dwell on this morning, but that word fasted, that's a little bit troubling, isn't it? We're good at fellowships, but the fasting part, that's another thing. And we'll see what the Lord does with all of that. But I'm going to ask you, when is the last time that you remember Lehigh Valley Baptist Church having a church fast? Where as a church, we covenanted before God to take time to fast and pray about some things. And that's something that we need to change. So they fasted, and the Holy Ghost said. The Holy Ghost said. Now I want you to see there in verse 2, this was a congregation that knew when God was speaking. And it wasn't weird. Brother Merrick, I was talking with him before Sunday school, and I told him I didn't sleep very well because I had a lot of dreams. And then I was joking. I said, that'll be the subject of the Sunday school lesson this morning. I'm going to share with the church, you know, this new revelation that I've gotten. No, I'm not really. All right. But as a church, are we tuned in to God speaking to us? We spoke not this last Wednesday, but the Wednesday before that, about how the communion of the disciple is in the Word of God. And then on Sunday, we also went into the Scriptures and we saw in our Bible discovery groups about how God speaks to us through His Word, and we're responsible to be obedient to Him. We need to be responsive to Him. You know, as a church, individually and also corporately, we need to be hearing the voice of God. That's the mark of a spiritual church. Many people have a form of religion but deny the power thereof. What that means is they deny that God is real. They deny that God is a living person. They deny that God can really speak, that God is able to make His will known. I want you to know this morning, God can make His will known. God can tell a congregation what His will is. He can lead us in a direction. But the question this morning is, are you and I as individual members aware of and obedient to the voice of God? Are we listening to God calling? If God said, there's someone else that I want to send, would we hear Him? Would we be listening to the voice of God? Now, think about this question and really listen to me this morning as I ask this question. Is it really possible that God would not lead a church to be involved in equipping and sending laborers into the harvest? Is it possible that there's a second class of churches that God just doesn't lead them to raise up men and to send them into the harvest? What do you think?
No.
See, the very purpose that God put us here is to equip men and to be a sending agency. That's what God wants us to do. And by that, to give glory to God. And so if we're not doing that, then we're not doing our job. This would be like a car dealership that never sells cars. And you go to the car dealership and they have no cars on the lot. And you say, I'd like to buy a car. And they say, oh, we don't do that. We're one of these, we're a different kind of car dealership. We have coffee for anybody who wants to come in. And we sit and talk and we read car magazines together. And we talk about the latest and greatest cars. And we have a great time. You know, it's wonderful. You're welcome to come anytime. You say, but I want to buy a car. No, this isn't the dealership for you then. That would be weird, wouldn't it? Because you'd say, what kind of a dealership is that? That's really strange. How do they make any money? How are they going to continue to exist? Can I ask you a question? As a New Testament church, if we don't get the vision for sending men into the harvest fields, how will we continue to exist? Reproduction is the mark of spiritual life. This church, the church at Antioch, was a church that was spiritual. Now, I want to ask you this morning, what is it that prevents us from hearing the voice of God in our individual lives? And as a church, what is it that prevents us from being tuned to the voice of God? I don't have all of them, but I'm going to give you three suggestions that can keep us from hearing the voice of God. First of all, there's distractions. Did you ever get distracted in your life? You just get focused on something that's not important and you miss something that's really important. This can happen in parenting, can't it? And you get so caught up in just the day-to-day stuff that you forget about plugging into your kids' lives and spending time with them and showing them that you love them. And next thing you know, time's gone, your kids are gone, and you look back and you say, man, I wish I would have done it different. Distractions. Distractions can take place. Distractions can take place in a church. It is possible for a church to get the wrong focus. You say, what does that focus look like? Well, you know, we can get caught up in activities and programs. And we can get to the place where we think, you know, being a church, We love our church, and I hope you love your church family. We love having dinners together, and we love having pie fellowships together, and we love having dinner on the grounds together, and we love doing this and doing that, and that's fine. That's a good thing. It's good to spend time together, and that's a wonderful part of being a church family, but that is not why God put us here. God didn't put us here to have bake sales. He didn't put us here to have fundraisers. He didn't put us here to run programs. He put us here to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. If we get distracted from that, then we'll find that our focus will become less than spiritual. We won't be tuned in to the voice of God. You know, many church members are more concerned about how comfortable or uncomfortable the pews or the chairs are than they are about whether that church is sending men into the ministry. I'll be honest with you, I'd rather be part of a church where there weren't any chairs and we all had to sit on the floor if it meant that we could send men into the mission work, into the field. We have to have the right focus. Distractions can really get a hold of our mind. The second thing that can prevent us from being tuned to the voice of God is we start believing the lies of Satan. Because Satan is always whispering in our ear, and he's trying to tell us about the purpose of our life and the purpose of our church. And he says, here's what it's all about. Here's the real purpose. Here's the thing, you know. And sometimes you say, you know, how do churches get in the place where they end up with a rock band on the platform and it's more like a theater set than it is a church, and it's like a social club where people are not even worshiping Christ. They think they're worshiping Christ, but there's no genuine spiritual life. They don't even have a genuine testimony of salvation. How in the world does that happen? It happens because people start believing the lies of Satan. And he doesn't try to sell us a big lie. He sells us little lies until he leads us down a path to where we're no longer effective. You know, the churches there in the book of Revelation, the seven churches of Asia, some of them were in danger of having their candlestick removed. And I believe that represents their authority as a church. You know, there does come a time and a place where God can remove the authority from a church. That's not for us to say when that takes place, but it's God who says that that can happen. And that happens because a church, as a group, starts to believe some lies of Satan about the purpose of their church. We start to get too focused on worldly things. We start to get too focused on the material things. Now, we understand, you know, doing ministry in 2017 in the United States of America, there are certain things that we have to take care of. There are. There's just no way around it. We have to sometimes meet with zoning officials and deal with things that pertain to our property. We have to deal with water testing and we have to deal with the EPA, which is a lot of fun, a couple times a year and all that sort of stuff. We have to make sure that we maintain our building so it doesn't fall down on anybody while they're here. That we have to keep things up. We understand that there can be a physical focus and that we have to take care of those things. But you know, just like in your family, if you get so focused on keeping your house and your car and your grounds and you neglect your kids, you're going to regret it one day. The same thing can happen in a New Testament church if we start believing the lies of Satan about why we're here. We can start believing that the reason we're here is to keep a building. Listen, lost people can keep a building. God didn't put us here to keep a building. He put us here to proclaim the gospel. Here's the third thing that prevents us from being tuned to the voice of God, I believe, that I want to share with you, and that is an inward focus. You know what an inward focus is? Me, myself, and I. And this can happen to an individual, this can happen to a family, and this can happen to a church. And I want to explain how it takes place. You know, an individual can become inwardly focused. Sometimes when an individual, you watch, an individual will go through a time of sickness. And there's two different kinds of people, or there's two different kinds of responses. There's the person who says, woe is me, my life is terrible, I can't believe this sickness. Oh no, my life is falling apart. Everybody pay attention to me, everybody meet my needs, everybody come and take care of me. And what is it? It's an inward focus. But then, remarkably, you'll meet someone else with the same problem. And all they can talk about is this person that they dealt with and this person that they talked to and how happy they were to meet so-and-so and how they got to talk to this doctor and this nurse. And you're thinking, are you sick or are you well or what? I mean, this person is so excited about life. And you think, how can you be so happy when you're not so well? You see the difference between the two? And it's not just times of sickness. We as human beings are programmed to be inwardly focused, to think about what we want. Incidentally, this is why people become church hoppers. Because they go to one church and after a while they figure out that the people at that church are actually people. By that I mean they're actually sinners. And of course they think about themselves that they're not a sinner. But everybody else, you know, they're so offensive and they just don't do this and I can't stand going there. So they go to another place and they're happy there for a little while until they figure out that those people are sinners too. And then they say, well, I'm going to go to another place. And they end up in another place. And they find out those people are sinners too. And what happens? Well, there's no stability in their life. There's no sanctification in their life. There's no growth in their life because they've gotten inwardly focused. They've started to think the church is for me. The church is a place where I need to feel comfortable. The church is where I come to get my needs met. A family can become like this. Be careful. You know, a young couple can get married and they can get excited about their relationship, and it's good. It's wonderful. We have a number of couples that are going to be getting married this year, and we praise the Lord for that. It's good to see young families, people getting married, and young families in our church who are raising their family. But be careful that you don't get so focused on each other that you shut out the rest of the world. That you start to think our life is about us being happy, about us doing what we want. And we'll come to church when we feel like it, and we'll serve if we feel like it, and we'll get involved if we feel like it. You know what? Won't be much of a church if it's like that. You're going to find that if there's going to be ministry, then it's going to take people to minister. You know, people say, well, I don't want to work in the nursery. I don't want to work in the children's program. Okay. So then you're voting to have all the babies and the toddlers in the service. You see what I'm saying? And then those same people will gripe and they'll say, I don't like it. It's too loud. And the kids, they're just not paying attention and they're distracting. But you voted, see? And why is that? Because we get inward focused. We get focused on ourselves and what we want and on each other. And we've got to be careful. Individual, family, a church can get like this. A church can get to the place where we're comfortable with us four and no more. Where we say, or us 400 and no more, however many it is. We say, we're content with what God's given us. We don't really want anybody else coming because, you know, anybody else new is going to be different. And we're not sure if we have room to include them. And we don't know if we're going to like them. That's not what God put us here for. God put us here to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we've got to, as a church, keep from having an inward focus, keep from our ministries being inward turned on just maintaining the ministry. We've got to keep this spiritual mind. See, the Holy Ghost spake to them and they heard him. All right, I've got to hurry. The fourth mark of a church that God uses to be a sending church is they're sacrificial. And these thoughts all build on each other. But you notice there in verse 2, what did the Holy Ghost say? He said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Notice that the Holy Spirit said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul. Now, if you've been paying attention, then you know Barnabas and Saul were precious to the church at Antioch. They had come and invested their life now for a year teaching the truths of Scripture. They had been involved in the lives of these people. They were precious men in the church at Antioch, and the Holy Spirit came and said, I want those two men. I have a job for them to do. I want you to separate them to me. I want you to give them to me. Separation, even when it's for a good reason, is always difficult. It's never easy to say goodbye. But do you know a church that is involved in sending is going to have a lot of goodbyes or see you laters, however you want to put that. But there's going to be a lot of times when God's going to say, I want them for the work. And we say, well, we'd like for them to stay here. Don't you know, Lord, what they do here? And don't you know what they mean to us? And don't you know how they're involved? And the Lord will say, I want them for the work. Separate them. A church that is not sacrificial, a church that says we want to keep everybody here for ourselves, is a selfish church. And they won't be used of God to send. You see, there was a noble purpose in this separation. And the noble purpose was the glory and satisfaction of God himself. He said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I've called them. And in verse 3, it says, when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. They didn't just talk about sending them. They sent them away. And I want to point out real quickly that in this sending, there is a great deal of responsibility that is wrapped up. So it wasn't just they laid their hands on them, as in they put their hands on their back and shoved them out the door and said, go. No. The laying on of hands speaks of identification. It speaks of authorization. It speaks of them, in a sense, going with them to the work. Even though they couldn't physically go with them to the work, they were saying, we're going with you in our spirit. We're going to be praying for you. Now think about the responsibility that we have to the missionaries that we send. we have a responsibility to remember them. You know who they are? Do you know who those missionaries are that we have sent to the work? I hope you do. I mean, I really hope that when our missionaries, especially the guys that are from our church, that are sent out of this church, that when they come home from the field, you don't walk up to them and say, "Now, who are you?" I mean, hopefully we keep their pictures in front of you enough and you know who they are so that you can at least identify. Now, I realize that sometimes new people come to the church and you've not met those missionaries, and that's fine. But, you know, that's an opportunity for you to get to know them, because now you're part of this church and you need to remember them. You need to remember those missionaries. We ought not to have the mentality out of sight, out of mind. Especially in this generation, it's so easy to keep them at the forefront of your mind. So remember them. And second of all, pray for them. As a church, we are remiss if we do not pray for our missionaries. If we don't pray for the people that they're working with. If we are not praying for the region where God has placed them. If we're not praying about the burdens that they're carrying and the difficulties that they have. And you know, our missionaries don't always share those burdens. Sometimes those are private things that they share just individually with a few people. They're not comfortable putting it out in a prayer letter. But you know, there's things that our missionaries are dealing with. There's burdens that they have on their heart. We need to be praying for them. We need to be bringing that before the Lord and remembering them. A third of all, we need to support them. Support them financially. In other words, we're not just saying, go wherever you want to go and get a job and have a good time and we'll pray for you, brother, be warmed and filled. No. Well, we have a responsibility. And in this world, you know, there's many places where a missionary is not allowed to go and work. So they have to go having full support. If they were to get a job, they would have to become a citizen of that country. And that may not be possible. And so as believers, as a church, we need to be giving to support them. And you realize that as God calls more men to the work from our church, that costs more money. And we have to give to support that. That's what Faith Promise Missions is about. But we need to care for them. That word care has the idea of knowing what their concerns are and meeting those needs. And I appreciate so much how this church cares for our missionaries. I think you all do a great job of that. And you do care about our missionaries and you care for them. And it's a blessing to have our missionaries come home and for them to have a place where they can live, for them to have a car that they can drive. For them to not have to worry about those concerns. You know how difficult it is for a missionary who's on the other side of the world to pack everything that they own into a storage unit, fly back to the U.S. and not know where they're going to be living and not know what they're going to be driving. Those are just basic questions that they have to answer. And our church thinks about those things and you provide those things for our missionaries. And we appreciate that. We ought to continue caring for them. We ought to care for them on the field. We ought to care for them in the needs of their life. There are things that are important to our missionaries that ought to be important to us. You know that the Kastners are coming back for a couple of months, right? Here in just a few weeks. They're coming back in April. And the primary reason they're coming back is because Timothy is going to graduate from high school. And it's important for Timothy to be here and graduate with some of our high school seniors, because the day is coming when Timothy's going to come back from the field and he's going to live here in the U.S. and he needs to have that connection. Now, does that cost us something as a church? Absolutely. There's a cost that's attached to that. Is there benefit to that? Absolutely, there's benefit to that. And we have to be careful for those things. We need to think about those things and help our missionaries with those issues. We need to be involved with our missionaries. In other words, as you have opportunity, you ought to try to go and visit them on the field. You ought to get an idea of where they live. And when they come back here, you ought to try to get to know them and talk with them. Maybe have them over for a meal and get to know them and their children and make sure that they're connected with the church. We need to communicate with our missionaries. It requires sacrifice to communicate, doesn't it? It takes time. It takes effort. And depending on where they're located in the world, the time difference can be challenging. But we need to take the time to be reaching out to them and communicating with our missionaries. Just a short note to let them know that we're praying for them. You know, if an email goes out and they say, "Hey, would you pray about this?" Brother Kastner just sent an email update this morning, didn't he? How many of you saw it? Okay, not too many. So you need to go home and check your email. And here's what he said. They've been down in Machuti the last couple of days doing evangelism, and he talked about how God answered prayer. And he talked about how God opened doors and how open the people in the villages are and how excited they are. And sometimes we think, man, that's great. I'm going to pray for him. Just hit reply and say, hey, brother, I'm just praying for you, and I wanted you to know that. That means everything. Just a short line. It doesn't take but a few seconds to write it, but it means to them, oh, somebody read it. Somebody's praying about it. Somebody knows about it. All of our missionaries are on WhatsApp. If you don't know what WhatsApp is, come see me later, all right? All of our missionaries are on Facebook. Many of you are on Facebook. All of our missionaries have different means of communication, email, they have phone, they have a states-based phone number that you can reach them on. Use those things, communicate with them. And finally, when they come home to report what God has done, rejoice with them. You know, they're excited. In a lot of ways, sometimes they're bearing burdens, disappointments on the field, but many times they come back and they're talking about people whose names we can't pronounce, in locations that we've never heard of. And sometimes it's easy for us to say, man, I can't remember all those details. But you realize they're people that are important to our missionaries. And they are people many times who are members of this church because they've gotten saved and baptized under the authority of this church. And there's not been a church organized over there yet. So they're members of this church. And we ought to care about them. We ought to bear those burdens. We ought to rejoice with them in the things that God has done because their work is our work. We've delegated them to go in our place, and we ought to rejoice with them when the work is done. You see, a church that sends missionaries is a church that's going to have to sacrifice. It's a church that's going to have to give some attention and some resources to the work of missions. And that is the kind of church that God will continue to use as a sending church. And I've said all that this morning to say, I would like Lehigh Valley Baptist Church to continue being a sending church. We need to grow in these things. We need to ask God to help us to continue sending men to the work. It's been said, and I don't remember who said it, but it's been said that the measure of a church's effectiveness is not seen in its seating capacity so much as in its sending capacity. As a church, we ought to ask that the Lord would use us to send more and more people to the work that He has ordained. Our prayer as a church ought to be that God would make us more of a sending church. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this time together around Your word. And I pray for our church family. I pray that You would challenge us in this area. I pray for men that You might be calling to the work of the ministry here in this assembly. And I pray, Lord, that You'd make it plain in their mind and also in the minds of their fellow church members that You are separating them for a work that You've called them to. I pray, Heavenly Father, this morning as we go into our morning service and as we receive our faith promise commitments here in a little while, that You would help us to glorify You in this one aspect of being a sending church. I pray, Lord, that You would allow us to glorify You as we see more and more folks who are sent into the harvest fields of our Lord. Thank You for meeting with us now. Bless the rest of this day. May Your name be lifted up and glorified in the services that are to follow. We pray and ask these things in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning. You're dismissed about 15 minutes.